This is Wretched Radio with Todd Friel.
Can any good thing come out of Great Britain? Yep, this is Wretched Radio.
Hang
got
on.
Got some good British stuff. We've been hearing kind of not so good things going on in Great Britain when it comes to morality, values, worldview, no longer being informed by the Bible. Instead, it's mostly secular. This has, of course, been going on for decades. It's good to check in on an occasion, not so that we can tisk-tisk, not so that we can simply try to figure out a way to get those Brits to be behaving more morally. While that's nice, what does it profit an entire island if they have tea properly but die and lose their very soul? Doesn't matter. That is why individuals can be involved in political issues, no problem. But let's remember the message of the Christian, the message of the church. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a great British preacher of yesteryear, 20th century. Some pithy gems from Grace Gems. If you don't get Grace Gems, I encourage you to do so. It's absolutely free, gracegems.org. Every day they'll send you beauties. Do they send anything that's from a live person? I don't think so. I think in order to qualify for being quoted in Grace Gems, you have to be dead. I just noticed, and it made me sad, I saw some Grace Gems from Adrian Rogers. Kind of made me sad. Like it'll be like seeing Grace Gems from R.C. Sproul. Great to have those gems, but kind of sad those guys are gone, isn't it? Kind of sad those substantial heavy hitters. As they leave us, don't be in a panic. It's okay. the major work, like as wonderful a blessing as it is for things like social media and conferences and tweets to thousands and thousands and thousands of people, as good as that is, let's remember the important work of Christianity is not done in social media. It's not done at conferences. Look, they are a blessing. I go to them too. The real work of the church is done in the church, locally, on the local level. That is where the real heavy lifting happens on a daily basis. And that's why you got to be praying for your pastors. I'm telling you, those guys, they're doing stuff. I'm telling you, it would make your eyebrows curl. Maybe, hey, wait a second. Eyelashes, there's an eyelash curler, isn't that? No,
there
that's
is.
Your eyebrows.
You no,
well, yours
eyelash
are
curler.
Just because you got fishing line
curler.
Going on up there. Eyelash curlers.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, this is why pastors have curly eyelashes, because of the stuff that confronts them on a daily basis. It ain't easy being a local pastor. That's the big work. Don't panic when we lose the big guys. They're a blessing. We praise God for them. But Jesus will keep building his church even without them. Pithy gems from Martin Lloyd-Jones, who is a very soft-spoken fellow. Mm-hmm. I like watching his interviews on BBC. One of those days we'll share those. Very calm. And even back then in the 20th century, if we think that Great Britain and their morality poll indicates that things are lagging there, no. Martin Lloyd-Jones was up against it in his culture at his time, too. Middle of the 20th century. They were coming at him on BBC interviews into the 70s, 80s, coming at this guy. He was so stodgy. Do you really believe that your style of Christianity is going to keep up with the times? See, that's where people get confused, including those in the church. The church doesn't keep up with the times. The times need to conform to the message of the church. That's the order of events. Martin Lloyd-Jones, to divorce forgiveness of sins from the actual living of the Christian life is nothing but rank heresy. Indeed, works are not a part of salvation, but they are a result of salvation. And that's what James was trying to stress. If you don't have works in keeping with repentance, you don't have a saving faith. He was not saying that works are a part of salvation. Where's my My other Bible.
Is it over there?
We'll have to do it this Bible. Hold on. This is a great example of the Protestant Reformation analogy of Scripture principle that helps us to understand and harmonize the Bible. James chapter 2, James is talking about works. Where do they fit in the Christian life? And the Roman Catholic Church would say, well, they're a part of salvation. And you've got to do things in order to stay saved, maintain your salvation, in order to get to heaven, hopefully. And they will use James chapter 2, I think it's around verse 21, where it talks about your actions and your work. It starts in verse 13. Dear brothers, what's the use of saying if you have faith if you don't prove it by your actions? This happens to be the NLT. I happen to have it handy. That's the only Bible I have on my desk. That kind of faith can't save anyone. You see, it isn't enough to just have faith. Faith that doesn't show itself by good deeds is no faith at all. It's dead and useless. Now, in verse, I believe it's 21, it talks about Abraham. Yeah, verse 21. Don't you remember Abraham was declared right with God because of what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see, he was trusting God so much he was willing to do whatever God told him to do. His faith was made complete by what he did by his actions. This is not the most helpful translation because they're absolutely giving this a Protestant spin here. I'd rather confront the text the way it actually is. Joey, do you guys have a different Bible translation handy? Anything?
Let me go to the interwebs.
I got the ESV.
Oh, you don't have a Bible nearby?
I've got the internet.
I thought you were Christians. Abraham believed God. It was declared to him as righteous. He was even called the friend of God. Shouldn't have been made into a song, but nevertheless. So we're made right with God by what we do, not by faith alone. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward, isn't it? Joey, what do you got?
I got NRSV.
What? Give me NASB as long as you're a Bible lover.
What I'm looking for, NASB.
Right, give me NASB starting in verse 21, James chapter 2. Don't forget, you're listening to the most organized Christian radio program on this station at this time. Go.
Well,
okay, sorry, I've made a mistake here. Oh, there it is, NASB. What? Okay, what verse?
Verse chapter 2, 21.
21. Okay, was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up Isaac, his son, on the altar?
Stop right there. Wasn't he justified by works? Uh-oh. So now he goes on to say that Abraham, he believed and it was credited to him as righteousness. His works were justified him, says the text. Wait a second. So that says that works justify the person. So you do have to have works in order to be justified. No, that's not James' point. Keep going, Joey.
You see that faith was working with his works, and as a result of the works, faith was perfected. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, and Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone.
Okay, there you go. So he's justified by works and not by faith alone. So you go, wow, the Roman Catholics have got it right. Turn your Bible to Romans chapter 4. We see a longer treatise on this fellow named Abraham. And we use the clearer section of Scripture to interpret the unclear. I think that was three verses in James. I'm just going to burn through this for you. This is pretty much the entire chapter of Romans 4. Abraham was the founder of our Jewish nation. What were his experiences concerning this question of being saved by faith? Was it because of his good deeds that God accepted him? If so, he would have had something to boast about. But from God's point of view, Abraham has no basis at all for pride. For the scriptures tell us Abraham believed God and it was declared to him as righteous. When people work, their wages are not a gift. Workers earn what they deserve, but people are declared righteous because of their faith, not because of their work. King David spoke of this, describing the happiness of an undeserving sinner who is declared to be righteousness. Oh, what a joy. When their disobedience is forgiven, whose sins are put out of sight, though that joy is for those whose sin is no longer counted to them by the Lord. Now then, is this blessing only for the Jews or for the Gentiles too? What about Abraham? We have been saying he was declared righteous by God because of his faith. But now, did his faith help him? Was he declared righteous only after he had been circumcised, or was it before he was circumcised? The answer is God accepted him before he was circumcised. In other words, faith comes before works. And it goes into the circumcision ceremony. It is clear God's promise to Abraham. It is about faith. The law brings, now he segues, Paul segues into the law. The law brings punishment. The law brings death. You can't keep the law. You need to be credited with righteousness. So verse 16. So that's why faith is the key. God's promise is given to us as a free gift, and we are certain to receive it, whether or not we follow Jewish customs, if we have faith like Abraham's. For Abraham is the father of all who believe. On and on and on it goes. What do we do with faith and works? We interpret the unclear in light of the clear. And even though I think James is clear enough, Romans 4 makes it crystal clear. We do works because we've been forgiven, not to be forgiven. If you are a Christian, you will have works, but those works are a sign, an outworking of salvation. They do not work salvation for you. How do I know? Because James 2 makes it plenty clear. James 4, Romans 4 makes it crystal clear. This is Wretched Radio.
What the world would be like without Wretched. Nobody wants this. Please become a Wretched Gospel Partner.